Hi, hello, namaskara. In this session, we'll be seeing the concept of magnetic dipole. A magnetic dipole consists of a bar magnet or a small current carrying loop. Basically, small here means to say, like, if I view this particular conductor, what are the conductor I've shown in figure A, if I view it from a very far distance, it will be looking like a point source. Okay. So what we are trying to calculate here is, basically we are trying to show that a current carrying loop as well as a bar magnet both can act as a dipole, basically a magnetic dipole. So to show you that, here I have shown two diagrams wherein this is my kind of a cross-sectional view. So this is cross-sectional view, you can think of. And this is somewhere from the outside or a side view, you can think of a side view. So wherein this is a conductor I have shown, here the current is coming and here the current is entering. So I have taken a cross section of this whole conductor in this fashion and I am just slicing that conductor and I am showing something like that. Okay. So what this diagram shows is, if a current carrying conductor, if I use a right hand thumb rule, then you can know this is how the flux moves within and around that conductor. Okay, so the same way, if I have a bar magnet and the magnetic field around the bar magnet, if you see, the both the fields are comparative, both the fields are very much the same, hence I can think of they both have a similar dipole moment. So that's what we are trying to calculate in today's session. So to calculate that, what we are doing is, we are considering basically a small circular current carrying loop and I am trying to calculate my magnetic field. I am calculating the magnetic field at that point P. I am trying to observe that point P due to this current carrying loop. So what and how we do is, basically I can say now at point P, my magnetic vector potential, if you remember, magnetic vector potential was given by vector A. So that vector here is defined by the permeability times the current divided by 4 pi closed line integral of dl over r. R is the distance between the origin to that point P. So if you see this here, the radius A of the current loop is very much small compared to that of the distance R. So in a condition where I am very far away from the conductor, okay, very far away from this conductor, I am very, very far away from this conductor, my conductor looks like a point source and it is so small that if I have the R distance very much greater than A, then the loop appears to be small to the observation point at A, right? To the observer at the point A, it looks very small. Hence, if you see this particular wire, it only has 5 component. No other component will be taken into consideration. So with this, my equation 1 can be simplified as, A is equal to, the vector A can be simply written as mu naught I, and what is the circumference that it is covering? The circular conductor has a circumference or the area, you can write that as pi into r square, where r here is distance is A, the radius is A, it is pi A square divided by 4 pi, and this becomes sine theta, the angle with respect to the A phi cap, and the whole divided by R cube. After solving this expression, if you are interested, I'll be sharing a copy of PDF for this whole derivation, how we came from equation 1 to equation 2. So this is the simplification at that point P. So at that point P, this is my magnetic vector potential. So if you observe this, I can furthermore simplify this in terms of the magnetic moments which we had discussed in the previous lecture. This is my magnetic moment, where my magnetic moment is nothing but it is I times S is the area, right? S is the area in some direction n cap. If you remember this, this is what we had derived for M. I can do the same derivation over here, where my S surface area is nothing but pi a square. So if you see this particular part, it is nothing but my surface area. So in this expression, this whole term I times pi a square can be replaced by M, or the magnetic moment. Hence my equation A, I mean the magnetic vector potential A, can be written as A is equal to mu naught times the magnetic moment. And I can write this sine theta A phi cap as a cross product, and it is with the distance vector AR cap over 4 pi R square. So I've just taken this whole equation back to this form. This is for representational purpose I am using, okay? So don't worry with it. So this is a simplified version of equation 2 which we have derived. So from this, what we can do is, if I have derived my magnetic vector potential, can I define my magnetic flux density? If you remember the expression, magnetic flux density is given by del cross A, I mean curl of A is nothing but my magnetic flux density B. So I have to take the curl of A wherever the A I have got. This is the A I have derived. So if I take the curl of A, then I will be getting my magnetic flux density at that point B. To solve this, in our properties of curl video lecture, I had discussed about del cross A and how to solve it. So what I do now is, I try to solve this vector. I'll be applying my magnetic vector potential in this matrix, and I'll be trying to solve it. So if you see this vector, I can write the whole vector as the general vector. I'm trying to write the general vector. It is AR into unit vector in the direction r cap plus a phi in the unit vector a phi cap plus a theta in the direction a theta cap. So this is what your vector will be in terms of r phi, r theta phi format. So this both can be written like this, wherein in my expression the magnetic vector potential is only in the direction a phi cap. That means this term will be going to zero and this term will be going to zero. So I only have a phi cap available here, where a phi is nothing but the whole term. So you can think this a phi as, so I can write a phi here. A phi is just the magnitude, wherein a phi is mu naught times I pi a square sine theta divided by 4 pi r square. So this is my phi, I mean a phi. So if you see this matrix, in this matrix ar will be 0, r a theta will be 0, and r sine theta in terms of a phi, I'll be substituting this whole term, and then I'll be solving this matrix. So in your textbook, probably r square is missed out. They have simply written r sine theta 1 over r sine theta. You just have to take it as r square sine theta. And after solving this, this whole solution will be 0, because this and this are both 0. You'll be only solving for this and this matrices. So I'll be not solving it. Once you solve it, you will be getting a solution. I'll be directly jumping to the solution. If you don't get, let me know, I'll help you out in making a video on that. So on solving for this, I'll be getting my magnetic flux density B, which is nothing but curl of A, which is nothing but my solved solution will be mu naught I pi a square divided by 4 pi r cube times 2 cos theta in the direction ar cap plus sin theta in the direction a phi cap. So this is what I'll be, I mean, it is not a phi, yeah, it is not a phi, it should be a theta, right? A phi is not there here, so it should be a theta cap. So this is what I'll be ending up at. And again, you can see here, I'll further simplify this. This whole part can be written as what? It is moment, right? So I'll be writing it as moment. I mean, it's a magnitude, so it is moment m. So mu naught m divided by 4 pi r cube times 2 cos theta ar cap plus sin theta phi. So this is what my magnetic flux density that I have got at that point B. So if you remember, now I can try to compare this with my electrostatics part. Okay, I can compare this equation as well as my magnetic vector potential equation, that is equation 2, and I'll call it as equation 3. I can compare these two equations with my electrostatics. So I have a diagram of that, wherein if you see here, my electric potential was given by this formula and my magnetic potential, which we have seen now, is given by this formula. So if you see both of this particular expressions, you can compare it, almost they both are equal, right? Similarly, if you see these two things, that is my electric flux density and the magnetic flux density, they both again look similar. So that means that there is a correlation between my electric field and magnetic field. So in this particular lecture, what we are trying to do is, the magnetic dipole due to a current element, that is this, which is nothing but m equal to is this moment, the magnetic moment. We are trying to compare that with my bar magnet. So the bar magnet looks something like this, you can think of. So this is my north pole and this will be my south pole. So what are the flux that this creates? This also has a moment, and what we are trying to do is, this moment is equal to this moment is what we are trying to compare in this particular series. So for doing that, what we'll be doing here is, we'll be thinking, or we'll be trying to take my bar magnet as QM. I mean, let me show that particular figure. So what I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to take my bar magnet in this form, and I'm calling it there are two charges. Usually there are no monopoles in my magnet, but still we are trying to tell that there is a plus QM charge and minus QM charge. It is a magnetic charge, okay, assuming that there is a magnetic charge. If there is a magnetic charge, what happens? So if there is a magnetic charge, and when I come from south pole to a north pole, it has a length L, it is covering a length L, and this bar magnet is placed in a constant magnetic field P, then the moment, or the rotational force, or the torque, the moment that is experienced by this bar magnet can be defined by Q times the charge Q. The charge here is QM, we call it as magnetic charge or monopole, times the length L. So usually you have to keep in mind that Q minus QM and plus QM, there are no separate charges, but still, for consideration purpose, we are trying to take it as it is. We are assuming that there might be some charge, but usually there is no such charge. So the torque equation for this can be given by T is the torque, which was nothing but the moment arm cross B. So the torque expression is given by this, where we know now in this, moment arm is nothing but Q times, or magnetic charge q times L cross B. So if I say they are perpendicular in nature, then this can be solved as qm L B sine of 90, sine of 90 is 1. So qm L B is what my solved expression if I solve for this torque for a bar magnet. Okay. Similarly, if I say for my closed conductor or current carrying conductor loop, for that we had derived torque as T is equal to M cross B, if you remember, for that where M was nothing but the current carrying conductor with some area S times B, or in magnitude we would have simply written it as I S B, right? This was a torque for a current carrying conductor loop, and this is the torque experienced by my bar magnet. If I say that they both are equal, if I equate them, so let us equate them, q m l dot b, if I equate them with my current carrying loops magnetic field, they both BB get cancelled and my equation, my solution will be QM dot L will be equal to I dot S. In general, what this means that my moment generated by a bar magnet will be same as that of moment generated by my current carrying loop, right? So that means to say there is a moment for the bar magnet as well as my conductor, which acts in a similar manner. But if I show you in electrostatics part, wherein the vector field and electric field is defined for a charge, whereas in magnetic we don't have such thing because there is no dipoles. I mean, dipole concept is not there. I don't have a minus Q magnetic charge and a plus Q magnetic charge in my magnet. Magnet is one single element which has poles. You don't have monopoles in my magnet. I don't have separate north and separate south poles. But still, without having this separate monopoles, even after that, my magnet behaves and it has a torque. That is what we are trying to show here. That is what we are trying to prove here. Even though I don't have the poles, the magnet has a dipole moment. The conductor, the closed conductor which is carrying current, is acting as a dipole moment, which has the torque, which has a twisting force. So hence, if I show this two are the same thing, then they must have the same dipole moment. That's what we have tried to prove it here. Hope this is understood. It is not a very difficult concept. And again, the force experienced by a magnet, in a similar way, the force experienced by my charge, like if you remember in electrostatic, force experienced by a charge was given by Q times E, electric field intensity. They will sometimes define the force experienced by a magnet is given by QM times B. Where QM is my magnet pole and B is the magnetic field intensity. That is what they sometimes define, but it's not quite often. So this is how they usually define, and using this, if you remember our torque expression in our previous lecture, torque expression was also given by R cross F, right? If I substitute this again, where R is my moment arm, you can think of, I mean, the length of the arm. So the length here is L. So I can say this is L cross QM B. The force is QM times B. So after solving, again, I'll be ending up at QM L dot B. So this and this are both the same. In terms of force, if I do, I can solve in this way. In terms of just a bar magnet, I can solve in this way. Hope the concept is digestible by you people. If you have any difficulties, please let me know. I will help you out in understanding the concepts. It's easy, okay? Thank you.